to outer space to find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. Satan is a evilous man, but him can't choke sit on I man. So when I check him, my lass in hand, and if him slip a gun with him hand, I'm gonna put on a iron shirt and chase Satan out of earth. I'm gonna put on a iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. Oh yeah. Shirt and chase Satan out of earth. I'm gonna put on an iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. Satan is a evilous man, but him can't choke sit on I man. So when I check him, my lass in hand, and if him slip a gun with him hand, I'm gonna put on a iron shirt and chase Satan out of earth. I'm gonna put on a iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. Satan is a evilous man, but him can't choke sit on I man. So when I check him, my lass in hand, and if him slip a gun with him hand, I'm gonna put on a shirt and chase Satan out of earth. I'm gonna put on an iron shirt and chase the devil out of earth.
Me see them dove it on the gully bank. Me see them dove it on the river bank. Me see them dove it and them rub it in a boa bank. Me see them gone a Talaman.
I'm gonna send him to outer space to find another race. Send him to outer space to find another race.
knows it, y'all. Burn and burn and burn, and they will never hurt us, yeah. Chibam, chibam. Move, y'all. Goodness gracious. Chibam, 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 bam.
Josh, you're muted.
Hello and welcome to the Bookmarks fourth weekly Friday night event. Tonight we're joined by long-standing Socialist Workers Party member Shelia McGregor, who's written plenty about Marxism and women's oppression. And we're also joined by Camilla Royle, who is also a long-standing Socialist Workers Party member and the author of A Rebel's Guide to Engels. I'd like to obviously wish everyone a warm welcome. We'll be live for about an hour tonight, and obviously a happy May Day as well. But without wasting any more time, I'd like to introduce Shelia McGregor, who will be speaking for about 10 minutes.
Oh, sorry, I thought we were doing it the first way around with Camilla starting. But okay, well, I'll start with... Engels's writing in 1884. He wrote The Origin of the Family, Private Property and the State, 1884, a year after Marx's death. And what drove him really to write it, drawing on his own wide reading and also Marx's ethnographic notebooks, what drew him to write it was that he... wanted to counter some of the arguments in August Babel's book, which had been written in 1879, which was extremely popular, but which basically argued that women's oppression had already existed. So the importance of Engels's book was that it was precisely that he challenged the idea that women had always been inferior to men. He also challenged the idea that women's inequality was rooted in biology or in women's ability to have children. And he also challenged the idea that the family had always existed and was some kind of unchanging institution. Now, all of those arguments resonate today simply because we live in a world where the most common sense arguments are that the family has always existed, that it's unchanging, that women's oppression has always existed. I think it's particularly pertinent today, Engels's arguments, for two reasons. One is that there has been a resurgence of interest in Marx and Marx's on women's liberation. But there is a trend within Marxism which nevertheless rejects Engels's explanations of the origins of women's oppression, namely Heather Brown and Lisa Fogel. And then we also have socialist feminists, where it's emerged in the debates around trans, who actually argue that women's oppression is rooted in women's biology. So for all of those reasons, Engels is really, really important. Now, I want to make three points very, very quickly. The first is that Engels's starting point in the pamphlet that he wrote, The Part Played by Labour in the Transition from Ape to Man, is that it's our capacity for making tools and interacting with the environment in how we in how we survived, how we gathered plants, how we use plants in gathering food, and also in hunting animals, which was actually the key to our evolution as human beings as we know ourselves today. That is what drove the development of human beings, Homo sapiens, and led to the development of our large brains and our capacity to speak to one another, and that we emerged as social tool makers. Now, the key argument that Engels then put was that for the bulk of human history, 90% of what he called barbarism, and what we call hunter-gatherer society, 90% of our history was actually involved in hunter-gatherer societies, relatively small social groups of men and women who were both part of a collective, a social collective, where they took collective decisions, but also played an autonomous role in terms of food provisioning in that society, in which the fact that women could did bear children played no role whatsoever in terms of impeding their contribution to the society, their autonomy, their involvement in decision making, and so forth. And these are societies which were egalitarian, and therefore any idea that women have always been unequal, or childbearing has been has dragged women back and made them unequal, is completely belied by the evidence that we have, both from archaeological evidence and anthropological evidence. And we know from societies which were still existed up until about 50 years ago that such egalitarian societies existed. The transition occurred when Engels argues there was a transition to what is called horticulture, where hunter-gatherers began to settle for periods and build more substantial structures in terms of villages and starting to store food. This allowed for greater differentiation in terms of skills and occupations, and beginning to put pressure on egalitarian relations and structures which guaranteed that kind of autonomous contribution of women to society. And the final transition towards agriculture, which emerged about 10,000 years ago, initially in Mesopotamia, occurred as a consequence of the, we think it was as a consequence of climate change, which made people who'd lived in horticultural societies who had lived off of the provisioning of wild grains, actually had to turn to the development of the grains and through agricultural methods, what we call agriculture, because the wild grains began to disappear because of climate change, and therefore had to use their skills to begin to produce the food which they had been available on a more natural basis. And this transition to settled agriculture with more intensive planting and growing of food led to a situation where there was a production of a surplus within society, which was adequate to enable a small group to live off it, a greater differentiation in terms of occupations, like people who could carry arms permanently to defend that surplus, who could be involved in trading, who could be involved in more skilled metalworking and pottery working, and so on and so forth, but wasn't sufficient to lift the whole of society forward. And so the transition to a differentiation on a class basis, where a group controlled the means of producing everything in society, emerged, requiring the emergence of, as I say, of armed groups that could defend that surplus, but also required the breaking of any collective organizing in society, the development of the state, And also then that throws up the question of how do you control the means of producing in society in such a way that it remains within a particular class. And that then raises the question of the control over women's reproductive ability, which only women have, and therefore the rise of the family. So that Engels ties the rise of the family to the rise of class society and the rise of the state. And I think probably that's my time done, is it, Josh?
You've got another minute or two if you'd like to keep going, but if you
okay. All right, so the final question, which, so that's, at that point, Engels talks about the world historic defeat of women, because from having been playing an egalitarian role inside society, they then become subordinated alongside the majority of men to a ruling class, but they also become subordinated to men because of the control over their reproductive capacity and through the first form of family organization, as opposed to shared public living as it had been in the past. And the key to understanding why it was men who became the dominant force inside within the ruling class is the relationship between the production of the surplus and in Mesopotamia through the agricultural methods which were in the hands of men because of the central importance of the plough and men's role in draft animals in animals. It was different in other parts of the world, but perhaps I'll just stop there for the time being.
Thank you very much, Shelia. I'll make sure that I read some of your ISJ articles later today. Very, very interesting stuff. I'd just like to remind everyone that we are taking questions as well on Facebook Live. So if you've got any questions for either of the speakers tonight, please drop a comment. And if you're enjoying the live feed as well, please drop us a like and a share. Next up, without wasting any more time, I'd like to introduce the author of The Rebel's Guide, Camilla Royle. So Camilla, take it away, please.
Thanks, Josh. So Shelia has spoken about one of Engels' most important contributions, his understanding of women's oppression and the role of the family and how women's oppression came about and how we can have a more liberated society. There's lots more though that you could say about Engels. So in about 20 minutes, I'll try to highlight some of the events that he lived through and some of what he learned from those events, how they shaped him and his politics. And so I'll talk about workers' struggles and also hopefully about revolution as well. As I said in the book, that Engels was a disappointment to his parents and a traitor to his class. I think he's really the kind of prime example of how someone from quite a wealthy background can nevertheless become committed to workers' struggles and to social justice. So Engels was born in 1820, 200 years ago, in a place called Barmen in what is now Germany. It wasn't Germany at the time. At the time, that part of Europe was divided up into numerous small principalities, really dominated by the Prussian state, by the Tsarist Empire in the east, and by the Austrian Empire as well. Engels was the son of an industrialist, Friedrich Engels Sr., who was involved in running a factory, Ehrman and Engels, that produced cotton and other and sewing threads and things like that. So he was part of a kind of rising industrial class, really, in that part of the world. In 1841 to 1842, Engels goes to Berlin and to do his military service. This is an opportunity not just to be part of the military, but also for him to go out and meet people. He enjoys going out drinking, he learns to fence, he's very keen on that, he likes to smoke cigars, he likes to look good as well. This is when he starts cultivating his famous facial hair. Calls all his friends together and said, we're all going to have to start wearing moustaches now because this is fashionable. The picture that we used on the front of the book is a picture that was taken around this time. And so he was quite kind of ahead of his time on realising that photography was going to be quite an important way of getting your image out there. Probably more importantly, though, he starts to get acquainted with philosophical ideas. So he comes across a group called the Young Hegelians. These are people who followed the great German philosopher Hegel, although Hegel's been dead for 10 years by this point, but they still draw on Hegel's ideas. But they take up Hegel's ideas in quite a radical way. So Hegel can be interpreted in a radical or a conservative way, but the Young Hegelians, also known as the Left Hegelians, they really, what they like about Hegel is that his ideas are about the world being in a constant process of change and transformation. So it's ideas that kind of lend themselves to revolution and change. It's important to understand that with censorship and very few opportunities to organise politically in an open way at this time, then philosophical debate was kind of how people had the political debates at the time. They were kind of, they took place in the realm of philosophy, largely. Engels meets Marx at this point, because he's often associated with Marx, a lifelong collaboration. When they first met, they didn't actually get along that well. Marx was starting to distance himself a bit from Young Hegelian thought at this time. And I think he probably thought that Engels was one of the Young Hegelians still. So he didn't think much of him. Engels did start to write for a newspaper called the Rheinische Zeitung, though, around this time, which Marx was editing. The following year, something happened to Engels that changed his life in many ways, which is that he comes to Britain, and specifically to Manchester. And he was sent there by his dad to take care of the Engels side of the Ehrman and Engels business and their operations in Manchester, because the business is involved in textile production, which is a huge business in Manchester at the time. You look at what's happening in the city, it's becoming a big industrial city built on cotton and steam power. It's even described as Cottonopolis. There's huge migrations of people into the city, and the introduction of technologies like the power loom meant that woven goods were being produced by machinery, and the prices of woven goods were set by the price of the machine-made product. So instead of having people producing woven goods in family units with a spinning wheel and their own hand-operated loom and all that kind of thing, you had these big factories with machinery. The Industrial Revolution changed people's lives dramatically. It tore apart old relations of the family. It meant that everyone was going into the workplace, even women and children. It also changed the world, really, because you had cotton is, of course, grown by slaves in the Americas. The empire, including India, was used as a market for woven goods as well. What's also happening in Manchester at the time is that you see the rise of very militant workers' struggles. Notably the Chartist movement, a movement for universal male suffrage. But it's also about getting representation for ordinary working people so that they can improve their living conditions and their working conditions, as well as trying to, as organising massive petitions to try and win suffrage for everyone. They also took part in very militant strike action. So there was one called the Plug Plot Riots, also known as the First General Strike, where after wages were cut in Staley Bridge and in Manchester by 50%, the strike broke out, but it spread throughout Britain. At its high point, an estimated 500,000 workers were involved in it. They weren't just withdrawing their labour, they were also pulling the plugs out of the machinery to let the steam out to stop the machines from running and doing things like that as well. Engels describes armed brick workers breaking into the brick factory and smashing all the bricks overnight. He's very much aware of everything that's going on. He's acquainted with the Chartists, he knows their leaders, he writes for their newspapers. He also meets his partner Mary at this time. Sometimes it's kind of because she's from a very working class background. He's highly educated, she's literate, barely literate, but it's often kind of assumed that it's quite a one-sided relationship where he's the sort of dominant partner in it. Actually, it's far from the truth. She's teaching him as much as the other way around. She's showing him the workers' struggles and the conditions that working class people are living in. Engels writes his first book while living in Manchester, The Condition of the Working Class in England. He talks about the long hours that workers face, workplace injuries, precarious work, talks about air pollution, poor accommodation, lots of themes actually that we talk about today. You know, his descriptions of the polluted air and the accommodation that could be about Delhi or Jakarta. Now there's a description of workers' dwellings that are flooded and they're so disgusting that workers can't live in them, which is very strikingly similar to something I read about Jakarta just recently. He talks of particular relevance to what we're all thinking about right now. He talks about how capitalism created the conditions for infectious diseases to spread. So when he's referring to the cholera epidemic, he says that when the epidemic was approaching, a universal terror seized the bourgeoisie of the city. People remembered the unwholesome dwellings of the poor and trembled before the certainty that each of these slums would become a centre for the plague, whence it would spread desolation in all directions through the houses of the property class. He uses the term social murder as well. This is where the ruling class commits violence against the working class. It's not interpersonal violence. They're not coming up to people and grabbing them in the street and beating them up, but it's nevertheless still violence. It's putting the working class in conditions that they cannot hope to survive. This is something that, you know, critical thinkers talked about in the, you know, from in the 20th century. They talked about structural violence, but Engels is far ahead of his time on that. He's talking about this in the mid 19th century. But it's important to note, I think, that it's not just a description of the awful conditions that workers live in. Engels also has an analysis of why things are like that. He, around this time, he writes the outlines of the Critique of Political Economy, which anticipates some of the key points that Marx is later to make in terms of, you know, so Engels is already understanding at this time, for example, that it's workers that produce all the value within capitalism. After his return to Europe, he meets back up with Marx and they work quite closely together from this point onwards, actually because they've come to quite similar conclusions from their understanding and their experience of workers' struggles. In Marx's case, from the revolt of the Silesian weavers in what's now Poland. So they start to write down their philosophy and they start to clarify for themselves what makes them different from the young Hegelians in books like The Holy Family and the German ideology. And the German ideology was never published, but then they're writing out their ideas for their own clarification, at least. They distinguish themselves from Hegel because whereas Hegel is an idealist thinker, he thinks that ideas are the driving force in society. They are what makes things happen. Marx and Engels, their starting point is the perspective that it's a materialist perspective. They said that if we want to understand history, we start from real human beings and their needs and how they fulfill those needs, how they organize in order to produce and maintain the things that they need to survive. And Shelia has outlined this already and how it relates to the position of women, but it's important to note that there's many different ways that human societies can organize and all of them imply different relationships between people. So they criticized some of their young Hegelian colleagues. They, you know, also have political differences with them because some of the young Hegelians kind of veer into this idea that it's a small group of people that are going to win liberation on behalf of the masses. The masses are the enemies of reason, whereas for Marx and Engels, it's ordinary people that are going to change society. They also find it really important that socialists, communists, as they call themselves at the time, organise together collectively in groups. They become part of the League of the Just and they're able to take a quite central role in this organisation and transform it from what it was, a kind of secret society, into much more of an agitational organisation. Marx and Engels have set the task of drawing up a statement of the group's politics. This becomes the Communist Manifesto. Engels actually plays quite an important role in this because he writes the kind of draft of the Communist Manifesto, which is called Principles of Communism, which you can still find online today and is still very useful. What I wanted to talk about though in the little bit of time I have left was their experience of revolution as well, because Marx and Engels talk in the Communist Manifesto about a spectre haunting Europe. And I think these words would be prophetic, really, because after they write it, 1848, revolution does indeed break out across Europe. There's a global revolt on a scale that had never been seen before in any time in history, arguably hasn't been seen since. In 1847, there are bread riots in Paris. By March 1848, there are barricades up. The king was overthrown and forced into exile in Britain. There are revolts in Hungary, and there's a revolt in Vienna. Across a huge wave of Europe, actually, old feudal monarchies are overthrown. In many places replaced by national assemblies. The revolutions involve an alliance of liberal reformers and more radical forces. The liberals want things like universal suffrage and freedom of speech and rights for everyone. The radical thinkers, they want to put food on the table. They have economic demands as well. These demands, they can't really be fulfilled without a complete transformation of society at the root. So there's initially a kind of alliance between radicals and liberals in many places, but this starts to fall apart, most strikingly in France, where the National Assembly sends the National Guard to actually put down workers' revolt and murders a whole load of workers. And they elect a new Napoleon, and there's a return to order, but this kind of dynamic's playing out in other places as well. There's counter-revolution all across Europe. Where is Engels in all this? He's actually literally on the barricades. He was in Frankfurt as part of attempts to defend the Frankfurt Assembly against the forces of the Prussian state. He even takes up arms at one point, and apparently, you know, quite a good soldier. He has quite a lot of military experience, but ultimately this is a doomed attempt to defend the revolution. It's ultimately unsuccessful, and he's driven into exile, as is Marx. So their ideas about revolution and about workers and agency are tested in these circumstances. They come to recognise the need for independent organisations of workers, so they might work with liberals at strategic points. But they also say that workers need their own organisations and need to organise as workers and put their own demands that can go in some ways further than the kind of more liberal demands for freedom of speech and freedom of the press and things like that. This is an idea that gets taken up by Leon Trotsky many decades later in the form of the theory of permanent revolution. So to end with, Engels spends much of the rest of his life back in Britain. He goes back to his dad's factory and takes up in his late 20s a job that's quite similar to the first job he was doing as a teenager, and quite low level, but he rises up the hierarchy at the factory. But you know, he hates it. Eleanor Marx has this letter where she, Marx's daughter of course, has this letter where she describes how happy Engels was on the day he finally gets to retire and comes back and takes his boots off and says, I'm done with factory life. And it must have been very difficult in many ways, advocating for workers' revolution while also being part of the management of a factory. One of the reasons he does it, of course, is that it provides money for Marx. And some estimates say that up to half of his income gets funneled down to London where Marx is. It allows Marx to be able to have the time to write his great work Capital, and Engels puts a lot of pressure on Marx to get Capital finished, even though Marx is quite keen to procrastinate on that. So, I mean, the years immediately after the 1848 revolutions are hard times for Engels and hard times for revolutionaries. In general, they're broken and they're spread out in all over Europe. They're in exile, they're refugees. They're under suspicion from the authorities, but they're not defeated. And struggle did come back in the form of the Paris Commune in 1870, and revolutionaries are able to regroup and form the International Working Men's Association, also known as the First International. You get new unionism in the late 19th century. Engels lives long enough to see this and see workers' struggles come back to Britain. He sees the beginnings of what would later become the Labour Party as well. So Engels, and he was also incredibly well-read and diverse in his interests. He writes on a whole range of subjects, from peasant struggles to science to housing to military history, the family and women, as Sheila's already outlined. So it's, you know, an extraordinary life and some incredible times that he lived through, and much that he has to teach us today, I think. But I'll end it there and hear some questions.
Thanks a lot, Camilla. That was obviously a really great introduction to a great thinker. We have got a few questions, but I'd just like to remind everyone that if you would like to know a little bit more about Engels, a bit more in depth, the Rebels Guide is available on the Bookmarks website, which I'm sure will be in the comments somewhere. The first question we've got is from Feline. This is, I'm wondering what the speakers would say about the kind of criticism of both Marx and Engels, which uses the details of their personal lives to put into question their political theories and writings. Engels was a bourgeois factory owner. His relationships with Mary and Lizzie Burns are quotes taken from the personal letters of Marx, where he references prejudice and stuff like that. Does this call into question their political insights? I'll let you come to that in a moment. I'll ask two more questions first, and then we'll go back to the speakers. John asks, what do the speakers think of socialism, utopian and scientific? He says he thinks it is a fantastic introduction to the theoretical outlook of Marxism, brilliantly captured in the German film The Young Karl Marx that came out a couple of years back. And the third question is, Engels was influenced by his lover to see the cause of Ireland as being important to socialists. And can you say a little bit about that, please? Maybe you want to decide between you who answers what. And so.
I take number one. Camilla?
Okay. Sorry? I'll try to a bit on the other two.
Is that okay? Do you want to start or shall I? Oh, shall I start? Because I'm doing number one. First of all, I think it's important that when people bring up criticisms in terms of the personal lives of Engels and Marx and different comments they made, that we actually situate them like they were in the 19th century. And you can't apply the kind of criteria that you would today, because society changes. And so if you take the question of language, for example, we find enormously stressful when we hear, you know, when we see that Marx used the N-word in a way that just became absolutely impossible as a consequence of the Black Power movement in the United States in the 1960s, and nobody would dream of doing that today. So there are, secondly, if you take the whole question of sexuality, you take the whole question of homosexuality, of transgender, of gender fluidity, those are all questions which really arose subsequent to the lives of Marx and Engels. So it's a bit absurd to raise those sorts of questions in relation to the two of them. And what we actually have to look at is fundamentally, and I think this is really important, is A, whose side were they on? And it's quite clear that they were on the side of working class people and were immersed in the struggles of working class people fighting back and developed the ideas of socialist revolution. Were on the sides of women fighting oppression, and both wrote incredibly sensitively. I didn't mention, because of time constraints. But if you think that Engels has that wonderful sentence in his book, The Condition of the English Working Class, where he talks about the man who is at home and his wife is out of work, and he says, that unsexes the man. And then he pauses and says, well, if it unsexes the man, then it can't have been right in the first place. And you see that insight, the notion that women and men should play particular roles inside society because they're a man or a woman, is wrong. And that really comes out very powerfully in the origin of the family and so forth, which I talked about, where he actually develops this insight that the kinds of roles that men and women play in society are shaped historically and socially. And again, he has that wonderful paragraph where he talks about what will relations between men and women be like in the future. He says, well, actually, that's something that men and women will work out between them under circumstances when no woman has ever known what it is to be dependent on a man. And he has this, you know, this tremendous vision. And the only other thing I'd like to throw in is that, firstly, like Camilla has said, he continued running a factory, which I think gave him huge insight into actually the way capitalist economics worked. Because he actually was keeping marks, right? That's the reason he ended up, he hated it. That, and there are lots of, anyway. But the second thing is that his relationships with Mary and Lizzie were not the kind of master-servant relationship that people would like to portray it as. Actually, he had respectful, loving relationships with both of them. And he was absolutely devastated when Mary died. And the one time he nearly fell out with Marx was actually when, after Mary's death, and Marx wrote him a letter without even mentioning the fact that Mary had died. And Engels was so upset that Marx didn't really understand that what had actually happened to him. So, and the final thing is that both he and Marx kept up, were inspirational for people like, Engels knew Clara Zetkin personally, were really supportive to active leading women revolutionaries through the course of their lives. Stop.
Okay, shall I go on?
Yeah, would you like to go on? Any other questions, Camilla?
Yeah, so the first question was about socialism, utopian and scientific. I agree it's an excellent introduction to Marxism. So it's, I suppose, short introduction actually, and Engels gets a lot of information and insight into quite a short work. It was part of a much longer work called Anti-During, which is a response to a sort of, largely forgotten kind of German philosopher, but it was necessary that they respond to this guy's ideas because his ideas were quite influential within the German socialist movement at the time. But the short kind of truncated version of socialism and utopian and scientific is probably much more relevant today, much more easily grasped. So what Engels is really doing is kind of taking to task utopian socialists. These are often, these people very active in the early 1800s. They wanted a better world. They wanted equality for men and women, for example, better living conditions, better education for people. Very, well-meaning people that in some ways brought about real reforms. They, in some cases, utopians were able to set up like small colonies where they ran factories, but on much more egalitarian terms than most capitalists did, and educated the children that lived there, and did put in place quite a lot of good reforms. All of them, quite short-lived experiments in communist living. And what the problem Engels has with these people, even though he admires them in many ways, is that they seem to think that socialism is something that you can kind of impose on society from outside. Like you can come along with a good plan about how things would be so much better if things were managed and run in a different way. You can take a group of workers and put them in that kind of society, and that's how you can bring about socialism. You only have to do it once and then it spreads everywhere. For Marx and Engels, this is not how things are going to happen. How things are going to happen is that socialism is going to have to come about through revolution out of the conditions of the type of society that we live in now. The central contradiction being between the rulers at the top of society and the workers at the bottom. Capitalism creates a system where there's a mass of people that produce all the wealth in society and have an interest in running it, but it also makes it very difficult for them to take over society and run things for themselves. But it creates the conditions that make revolution possible. And that's the kind of vision of socialism that Marx and Engels are talking about, in contrast to the utopians. They call it scientific socialism. But they explain that kind of vision of socialism by talking about dialectics as well, talking about a philosophy that's about the whole world being being fundamentally dynamic and liable to change and full of contradictions, including within human society. I talked about this a little bit in the book as well. Engels on Ireland, that was one thing I didn't have space in the book to talk too much about. I mentioned it a little bit, but I think it's a really interesting topic, and it's an area where researchers are only just now beginning to find out more about what Engels had to say. So he planned to write a book about Ireland, we know that, which he never completed, but we know a lot of the early chapters do exist, and they're quite ecological, actually. They're about the kind of ecological conditions that exist in Ireland and about its early history. He visited Ireland, of course, his partner Mary was Irish. She visited Ireland with her and with Eleanor Marx, I think, Marx's daughter. So all of Engels and Marx, and especially the women in their life, were all very interested in Irish struggles and very committed to the cause of Irish liberation as well. When they went right after the after the Great Hunger in the 1840s and saw the devastating effect that had had on people there. And I think this is, it did have an influence in their understanding of colonialism and the effect that has on people. I think that Marx and Engels come to a much deeper understanding of colonialism later in their life. Early on, they don't talk so much about it, but in their later works, and especially in Marx's Capital, they do understand that there's this link between the development of capitalism in places like Britain, notably, and the devastation that is wreaked on its colonies, Ireland being the first colony. I think it's a research project for someone else, really, to look in more depth at what Engels had to say about Ireland.
Thanks very much. We've got a couple more questions, but first of all, I'd just like to remind everyone that obviously the book is available on the website to be posted out if you would like to get yourself a copy. The next question is from Jean, who says, what insights can we take from Engels and Marx in terms of how we fight women's oppression today? We've got another question from Rhoda, who says, can you say something about Engels' relationship with Marx, Freddie, Eleanor, and the housekeeper, Helen? And I think this will be the final question as well. Heather Brown makes quite a fuss out of the fact that Engels used Marx's ethnological notebooks to write Origin, implying that Engels didn't really know the subject and was wrong against what Marx wrote in his notes. What would you say about this?
Which ones do you want to do, Camilla?
Shall I try the second two again? Or you can say something more about them as well. I think, Engels' relationship with Eleanor Marx and with Marx's daughters is not difficult to explain. It's kind of a relationship of almost like an uncle to them, really. He's been around their whole lives. They go on a lot of holidays together and spend lots of time together. Eleanor Marx, when Engels died, people might have been to Marx's gravestone. It's a massive stone edifice up in Highbury in North London. Engels didn't go for that, and probably for the best, really, but he was cremated and had his ashes spread put in the sea in near Eastbourne, which is a bit of a diversion, but it was Eleanor Marks and her partner Edward Aveling who rowed the boat out and spread his ashes. And yeah, he was probably, Engels was probably a bit too sympathetic, I think, to Edward, who was in some ways an awful person. And I think Engels's kind of analysis of labour movements in the late 19th century were a bit skewed by his relationship with Aveling, who got a lot of things wrong. I think the main probably relationship people want to know about is about Helene and Marx and Marx's wife. So what historians think probably happened was that Marx's wife went away on holiday and Marx slept with the housekeeper, Helene de Mouffe, and they had a child, and the Engels claimed that he was the father of the child to kind of spare Marx's blushes. Really, that seems plausible. It's another example of how although they had a lot theoretically to say about women's liberation, and I think their ideas are really important, Marx and Engels were not perfect in the way they acted in their lives. I think it's also, we should also point out that Helene de Mouffe was not just an oppressed housekeeper who was just a passive victim. She was an intelligent woman and an astute political kind of commentator in her own right. After Marx's death, she worked with Engels, and one of the things that she was involved in was editing Capital Volume 2 and 3 for publication alongside Engels. So someone that understood the quite complex ideas in Capital and could explain them and could work on them. So a really interesting woman. Heather Brown and Marx's ethnological notebooks. I think it's probably implausible that Engels didn't understand what Marx was saying in the notes that he left on anthropology. It's right to say that a lot of what went into and Shelia could probably talk more about this, but a lot of the ideas that went into the origin of the family were based on notes that Marx had written, he'd left, and that Engels only found after Marx had died. But you need to also bear in mind how closely Marx and Engels worked together during the latter years of their lives. They lived 10 minutes walk away from each other, and they visited each other on an almost daily basis and talked about their ideas and constantly exchanged ideas between them. And so I think, Engels would have had just as good an understanding of anthropology as Marx did, if not better, actually. So that's, what I'd say in answer to those kind of criticisms, but Shelia might be able to say more.
Okay, just to follow on from that about this argument, it actually comes from Raya Dunayevskaya, who was one of Trotsky's secretaries. She was a brilliant Marxist in her own right, but she had this. She was very critical of Engels and accused him of misreading Marx's notebooks, and also saying that Marx never used the phrase "the world historic defeat of the female sex," and that Marx himself had thought that the differentiation between men and women came much earlier than emerges in Engels's book. My attitude, I don't think Krupskaya was right, Dunayevskaya was right about that, and so I don't think Heather Brown is right about it either. And I don't think that's the right approach anyway. Engels wrote the analysis, and he has to be judged in relation to his own analysis. And I think the fundamentals of his analysis of what drives the emergence of class and the state and the oppression of women and the family is correct. And I think, the rise of the family is a defeat for women. So I think the fundamentals are, and we should just ignore those criticisms. that's my personal view. Secondly, the only thing that I would quickly add about relationships with Marx, Freddie, Eleanor, and the housekeeper is that, from my understanding of it, Engels was distinctly unhappy at having to shoulder responsibility for Freddie. He did it because he knew it would have spelt the end of the, you know, the marriage between Marx and Jenny, which was hugely important. But I don't, anyway, I just wanted to lob that in. In terms of insights that we can take in fighting women's oppression today, I would actually single out two things, particularly from Engels. One is that both Marx and Engels were absolutely clear in their own minds that Engels referred to as the reintroduction of women into public industry. In other words, instead of women just working in the home, women actually working in being exploited as part of the working class was really, really important for creating the basis, and Marx says this in Capital, but creating egalitarian relations between men and women, because they actually face the same, they're exploited, and therefore the question of class struggle means that men and women are going to have to unite as part of the dynamic of class struggle, and that is hugely important. The second thing which I think is, both of them thought that the family was going to disappear, but nevertheless, and they were wrong about that. But one of the things that Engels talks about, which is hugely important, is he talks about the reintroduction of everything that women do in the home, that becoming a public industry. In other words, the socialization of housework and childcare. And that is absolutely fundamental to the question of the liberation of women. And that is, you know, very, very clearly articulated by him. And the third thing, which I think is absolutely crucial, and is very strong, obviously, in Marx, is that when you have inequality and oppression, whether it's sexism, whether it's racism, whether it's homophobia, transphobia, one of the central questions is how do ideas change? And they're both Engels and Marx, but particularly Marx, the idea is how do people change, become different from what they are? We all carry the muck of ages with us. How do we get rid of the muck of ages? It is through the development of struggle where people begin to change. It's through resistance that people begin to see that they need one another in struggle. If you're in men and women in the workplace, or you need solidarity from another group of workers, that you actually have to begin to accord one another respect and equality. And we know that from major struggles. And if you think of the transformation in terms of attitudes which are happening at the moment with the COVID crisis, the transformation in attitudes when people suddenly realize just how dependent they are on essential workers, women and men, and overwhelmingly BAME men and women in the health service, in the care services, as transport workers, as bus drivers, and so on and so forth, people suddenly click that that racist ideas about migrants actually do not fit the reality of who we depend on at the moment, and that, you know, is also a central part of their thinking. So there,
thank you very much. I'd just like to finally say that obviously we are doing these events weekly on Facebook Live at the same time at 6:30 on a Friday, and next week we've got another great event with Martin Empson, who's speaking in a forum with Canadian activists on system change, not climate change. I would like to invite the speakers back to just have a final say, but we do have one more bonus question that I'd like to put to the group, and that is, let me find it. What lessons from Engels can we use to effectively and practically improve workers' rights and conditions today? So I'd like you to, if you can, answer that. And then if you've got anything else that you'd like to add, that'd be fantastic. And I just would like to say a big thank you to everyone at home. We've had about 70 people joining in today. And obviously, stay safe, stay socialist, and buy bookmarks.
I'll go first and leave Camilla to sum up. I would say that given that what is extraordinary about the lives of Engels and Marx, particularly Engels, is from being an active revolution in a revolution like he was in 1848, through the dark period of the 1850s and 1860s, when there was very little struggle, and then throwing himself, as did Marx, into supporting the struggles in around the Paris Commune, he was always dedicated to the idea of the self-emancipation of the working class, that workers, that revolutionaries required to get rid of capitalism, and workers themselves were central to that process. That's one thing. And second, and that you also had to organize, that there are times maybe when there's only a few of you, but there's other times when you when there are millions of people who are prepared to take about change, and the importance of being engaged in political debate and argument with people the whole time. That for me is, if you think of what we're facing now with the depth of the crisis because of COVID, both economic and health-wise, that actually that idea that we have to combine fighting as the best we can, stopping a return to work on unsafe conditions, for example, continuing to fight for proper testing and PPE and so forth, and fighting racism and fighting all the consequences of extra domestic abuse and so forth. So we're fighting on all of those fronts the best that we can. We have to combine that with a debate and an argument that we cannot have change from above through Parliament, through the Labour Party, through Keir Starmer. That won't work. That actually what we need to do is to build a kind of revolutionary organisation which articulates the self-emancipation of the working class. And that is why I'm here, what the importance of Engels and Marx are, and why I think we have to build the Socialist Workers' Party. We actually have to build the instrument by which we can emancipate ourselves. Over to Camilla.
That's great. I agree with that, of course. I think just wanted to sort of talk about why Engels is important as well, because of course we call ourselves Marxists, we don't call ourselves Engelsists or Engelsians or whatever. And yeah, Marx was an incredible thinker and, you know, rightly a giant of political philosophy. I don't think he would have been able to do that without Engels, though. It's not just about financial support either, or about the information that Engels was able to give Marx due to his inside understanding of how factories work. That's, you know, all important, but Engels was actually, in many ways, an incredible thinker in his own right. He was coming to many of the same conclusions about philosophy, about materialism, about economics and how the economic system works. Yeah, at the same time as Marx was, and yeah, possibly even before Marx, really. You know, Marx was off doing a PhD in Greek philosophy, while Engels was already in his early years a political journalist that had written about the conditions of the working class. Yeah, as Shelia said, his ideas are about self-emancipation and about the need for people to organise together. And I think, you know, what I take from Engels, and particularly about what he wrote about the working class and the way he wrote, is that he doesn't look down on working class people. He really sees them as the people that are going to be able to change the world. He's not like some of the other left thinkers of his time who think that then it's just going to be a small group of intellectuals that lead people to revolution. He thinks that, you know, whatever, however maybe unlikely it seems it's going to be the ordinary workers, the most downtrodden, who ultimately lead workers' struggles. And you know, in many cases they're not downtrodden, in many cases they're very articulate and able to speak in front of huge crowds and to express their ideas in a way that you know, any academics can only dream of. So I think that's what we learned from Engels. He's talking is things like pollution, about how we relate to our environment, about struggles in cities, people migrating into cities in big numbers and taking part in strike action, like precarious work, people being thrown out of their work and becoming unemployed in big numbers, as we see today with the COVID crisis. So I think if you look at the kind of struggles that we've started to see around the world in the past couple of years, the environmental struggles in cities around the world over neoliberalism, you know, whether it's in Chile or Sudan or Algeria or Hong Kong, I think Engels would have had a lot to say about these struggles. I think he would have seen these kind of mass movements as the way forward.
So why?